Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 26 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. Can you believe it? Almost 30 episodes already. This week, we are joined by Mr. Tony Durso. Tony is a three-time best-selling author whose titles include Easy Sales Procedures and The Good, Bad, and Gold, The Pursuit. That is an awesome name. Wish I would have came up with that. His fourth book is launching right when this podcast is, about March 2017, called Elite Entrepreneurs. He's also the host of the Revenue Chat podcast, where he gives you simple procedures to generate revenue in good and bad times. Tony is tremendous. He was very giving of his time. He was actually nursing a cold when we recorded this, and he still brought value anyway. And he has a really amazing story to share. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Mr. Tony Durso. All right. Thanks for joining me. I have the distinct honor of talking to Mr. Tony Durso. Tony, thanks so much for taking the time.
My pleasure, Temi. I'm very glad to be of help in a way and help you with the start and launch of your podcast, which, by the way, I've listened to a couple episodes. They're very cool. And, you know, thank you so much for having me on.
Oh, I'm flattered. I'm flattered to be talking to my fellow podcaster. So you have, you know, you do Revenue Chat podcast, and you've had the opportunity to talk to a lot of good people in the industry, but you didn't start out that way. The road to that was, you know, tends to be a winding one. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you get first bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with marketing and podcasting and all things digital?
Well, sure, Temi. It's an odd story because the roots of that is in the corporate world. I was a C-level executive. I helped form and founded an insurance technology company, and I was doing gangbusters, and I was approaching mid six-figure income and just doing very, very well and rocking. And I wound up getting an invite of a sort by a company to do exactly what I was doing, but do it for myself. So I was sort of almost, I was actually invited to be an entrepreneur, and I thought it was a great opportunity to move into something and be more in control, call the shot. So I went into and formed my own business, and I got very deep into lead generation. I was the VP sales and marketing for that company, and I was all over the spawning of the internet and how things were going and where things were going. And I was all into lead generation and online marketing. And so I just continued and built a nice business there. But what occurred to me is, because of the internet changing and various other things changing in the industry, rules, especially federal rules and regulations, changed four times. That's four times in 7 years that took me out of business multiple times. For example, I had a client, I was doing over $1 million in sales annually with one client. And one day on a Monday, I just got a cancellation. And I was like, what happened? And it turns out that there was a new federal regulation, and the attorneys thought that we had to redo the way we did business. And it was a big, long story, and they had to stop, and I was out of that large client income. And other changes kept happening, and I kept looking for something that I could better control myself. And I kind of fell into podcasting about a year ago. I think it was now fall of 2015, and I started podcasting and looking to generate what I was doing before, but from a different way. And I had written a couple books, so I tried it. I liked it. There's no income at first because nobody really knows who you are or what you are, but I used my abilities of marketing and advertising and promotion and so forth, and I built it up to, in 1 year, I just about hit 500,000 downloads, which is for a new podcaster, that's apparently very sizable. Mm-hmm. And I proved that I can do it. And so that was kind of how I got into it, and I just love it. And I'm getting so many nice reviews and accolades and people liking my show. And I really want to just help the entrepreneur and in a way give back, you know. And that's what actually the show is all about, is giving back to the community and helping people in startups, entrepreneurs, small to mid-sized businesses. And it's just really taken off, Temi. It's really, you know, I've wanted to do it, but I've had help in making this happen. So it's just a great thing all around.
I love it. Thank you so much for sharing that, because that was a jolt just having a client leave you like that. So you may have already answered the next question, but when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned with entrepreneurship, but, you know, when did that sort of shiny veneer come off? It's sort of like being married, right? When you first start, you know, this person can do no wrong. You're so in love, but then you find out, you know, they snore like a dying moose, or you know, fart and all this good stuff. So when did that sort of shiny veneer of digital entrepreneurship come off for you?
That's a very interesting question, because I've had several very bad moments throughout my entrepreneurial journey. As I mentioned, I had four major industry changes over a period of 7 years, and my income was probably the best roller coaster ride out of any amusement park in the world. It just kept going up and down and sideways and crazy, and it was just so hard to manage. It became very old fast, and that's why I was looking for something. But believe it or not, the even more worse moment, if you can imagine something more worse than not making any income and being out of business, if you can imagine anything more worse than that, that actually happened during my first year of Revenue Chat, where someone got a bug, probably, I'm thinking now, March, April-ish in that period, 2016. Someone seemed to have gotten a bug, or maybe it was some teenage kid wanted to experiment with me, and I became that person's project and hobby, and this person or entity continued to tear down my website no matter what I did, remove things, destroy things, delete things. That was almost enough to make me totally throw in the towel. In fact, if I had anything else to fall back on Temi, I would have bailed, because I was out, my website was gone, everything deleted, person got in everything, shut things down, closed things, 404 attacks, you name it, my website gone for a while, I had to reschedule guests constantly. It was probably the worst nightmare. I couldn't wish a nightmare like that on anybody. It was just that bad, and I almost literally threw in the towel, but I had nothing else to fall back on. The only way out is the way through. So I really suffered to get back on and build and put in all the security fail safes that I could to keep from getting hacked. And I just wound up persevering. I mean, I'm not a quitter, even though I was really, really hurt inside.
Wow. That's a harrowing story. Thank you for sharing that, because we actually got hacked by some Russians ourselves, and so I know what that's like. Not to the extent that you just described, but we have had instances where people have just decided to screw with our site because they can, more or less, so that's no fun. Now, given your experience, if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum, yes, I watch Doctor Who, what are the top three things that you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
Well, first of all, just for the record, I have not watched Doctor Who, but my wife has, and she's constantly talking about it.
My significant other actually got me watching it, so yeah.
Well, let's see. I would go back and tell my younger self, buy Apple, buy Microsoft.
Buy Google, buy all of that.
buy. And believe it or not, I would tell my younger self, watch who you're dating, and I would wait for my wife. I've been with her about 24 years now, and she grounds me. She keeps me planted on this earth. In a way, she keeps me fixed and stable, and she is an amazing, stable person when all else goes crazy. And I don't go very crazy very much, but she's a very steadying, stabilizing influence. So I would tell my younger self to look out for this one and catcher and make sure that I have her. And in terms of like advice, I would tell myself to get into podcasting because it seems to be my calling and it's so good to help people. And I would pretty much tell myself to do everything that I've done, you know, get a domain name out on my name as soon as it comes out on the internet, write my books, impart and share my knowledge with others, do public speaking. I pretty much would do all the same. I mean, these are things that I really love. And while it's taking, let's call it years of hard knocks to learn, you know, this and that and this and that, it's so worth it at the end, you know, to have what I've accomplished. And it wasn't easy, but I would tell myself to persevere and not give up despite it all.
I agree. I would have started podcasting years ago. This podcast is going to launch in early 2017, but just the reception I've gotten from people I admire, like yourself, Jason Falls, Mark Schaefer, very approachable, and it's a very enjoyable thing, podcasting. So I'm right with you there. So we are going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Mr. Tony Durso. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. Without getting political, but by all means, you know, be candid because candor is the whole point of the podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news on Facebook controversy / crackdown? Because after the 2016 election results came out, Facebook received a lot of backlash for the fact that in the last 3 months of the election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. And at first, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off. He was like, oh, it's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the results. And then when the actual numbers came out, he was like, okay, we're going to crack down and we're going to roll out a verification process. And Gemini that I am, I sort of flip-flop between my positions. At some points, I'm strictly First Amendment. Like, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to, you know, say what's true and what's not. But on the other hand, I'm like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what happens on your property, be it terrestrial or digital. Say that you have a pool in your backyard, and I don't know that you do, and some knucklehead kids hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping, and one of them drowns. Well, you weren't home at the time. Those kids were trespassing. It doesn't matter. It happened on your property, so you are ultimately responsible. So, do you have an opinion on whether or not Facebook should, you know, sort of be the arbiters of truth online, or do you feel like, you know, they don't have a responsibility at all?
Boy, that's a real tough question there, Temi, because Facebook is a business, first of all, and their business is to promote and promulgate and get advertising and get people together and stuff like that. They're not necessarily a governmental body in terms of oversight and who's being truthful, who or who is not. There is really no oversight in terms of what news is correct or not. Any and all news can be slanted and does get slanted, and things can be put into a favorable light no matter how bad it is. You could take someone who is not a good person and has, you know, done bad things, but you could put out a press release and make this person seem like a saint. So where does it stop? You know, I don't blame Facebook for what they're doing if they're just trying to get something done, but there definitely has to be some kind of oversight, because literally and truthfully, anyone that can type can put out a press release and say anything they want. And now, how do you even know what's true or not? You have no idea the amount of what's true or what's incorrect information out there. And people generally are susceptible to, if they read it and see it, they believe it. And so the public opinion can be and does get molded. You know, that's just how it goes. Every election, the public opinion is very heavily molded into liking one candidate over another. You know, we as individuals don't like it. We just want the straight scoop, but we're not getting it. And I think it requires a redesign and a restructure of the system. But the people who enjoy putting out the news to favor their operations, these people who they're not necessarily going to just step over and let you control that. So it becomes a very interesting paradigm here to correct, because the people who are in charge aren't going to let give up their reins. So now what do you do?
Right. And it's a pickle. It's a good pickle, because like you said, Facebook is a business and they're a publicly traded company and they have a fiduciary responsibility to, you know, return a profit. And one of the things that makes them very attractive is their just uncanny ability to target specific things. And in the interest of that, within their algorithm, they've sort of figured out what people like and then they serve up more of it. Right. And but the quandary there is that, again, some of it's factual and some of it's not. So, yeah, it's just a hard question. It's just a really interesting space. And you know, like I said, I don't know where I land on it, just to be perfectly honest. But yeah, thank you for that. I appreciate your point of view. So
you know, Temi, if we had some rather simplified, it can get complicated later, but just some rather simplified advocacy groups that take a look at some of this fake or bad or incorrect news and go after and target them and go after and expose them. I think by several of these sources being exposed, it will help balance out the area a little more and help make those that do issue the bad news more careful in producing good, proper, and correct information instead of just say whatever they want. Because, you know, some of these people, they really think that the world is like a bunch of five-year-olds in kindergarten. And you can tell them anything you want. You could go into class tomorrow and tell kids that it's Valentine's Day the next day and, no, and it's not Christmas. And you could say anything you want and they will believe you. Maybe one won't, but the rest will. And you can do anything you want with these kids and tell them anything at any time. You could make it Christmas every day. You could say you live on Mars. Whatever you say, you'll believe, because why? You're the only source of communication for them. They have no other way, no other senses. You know, there's really two ways to know things. One is if you observe it yourself, and the other is if someone else observed it and tells you.
Right.
So therein lies the paradox here and the issue of what we have to deal with. And I think some consumer groups could, you know, would have to be funded, of course. Someone would have to fund it, and that would be another burden on who the people. But by exposing some of them, it can help bring in some oversight into this, and maybe that's another way to do it.
Maybe, and I really like that as well. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day, and I do appreciate you taking the time, even though you're getting over a cold. I know it's a lot. This is a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his podcast, but I'm steering it in a very specific direction, so I am going to take just a few minutes to set it up, because I want you to know, you know, why I'm asking it the way I'm asking it. Plus, every podcast is somebody's first podcast, so I don't want to assume whoever's listening knows my position. So in my opinion, there's a severe gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a corporation or agency or works at a brand. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're professionals because they operate at such a high level. That's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 or a 1099 at the end of the year. So just using my own journey as an analog, you start off meandering the wilds of Google with varying degrees of success, but there's absolutely no guarantees there. You might land on a good resource like a lynda.com or a Businesses Grow or Marketing Prof, something like that, or you might end up doing Amway. Like who knows when you roll the dice on Google. And at some point, you decide to get serious. And at that point, there's sort of two options in terms of career trajectory. The first one is you can do what I did, was to go back and get a degree in digital marketing. The problem there is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my bachelor's, and it's time consuming. Even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And 30 months in the online space, that's like a lifetime. But by far the more prevalent way that people disseminate best-in-class practices and educate themselves is through conferences and seminars. The problem there is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less than getting a degree, you have to have that money up front. So take a top-tier conference like a South by Southwest or a MozCon or a Marketing Profs B2B Forum. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, food for however many days. No, just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you add back in those other things, you're looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And typically, there's like a VIP coaching program or a mastermind group that you can join, and those can be in excess of $10,000. So even though $10,000-$15,000 is a lot less than $60,000, you gotta have that money up front. So just, you know, I'm trying to crowdsource, if you will, ideas of how one professionalizes himself without either rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to pluck up a lot of money up front to attend conferences, which some people can't. So now that I've just taken time to do that, let me ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world. identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skills, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, baby. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, internet, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Believe it or not, that's easy.
All right.
Well, here's what I would do. Okay, I got the game plan. All right. Let's see here. Well, the first thing I would do is, if I'm in this alternate world, I again would go search out, see if I could go find my wife or her alternate and see where that goes and take care of that. All right. So now I have no money. All right. So I've got to go do something. Great. I'll join the top three, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter, and work them every day, meeting people and getting something going there in terms of connections. I would go to the local speaking association. They usually have a very small annual membership. I don't have any money, but they have 1 month free. So I'll join them. And here's where I'm just going to meet people, meet local people like crazy. I'll start doing speaking. I'll do free speaking gigs. And sooner or later, I'll actually start getting some income and do some small gigs. Even if I made 100, 150 or 200 bucks for a speech, because I have a lot of information, I start doing that. As soon as I get some income, first thing I'll do is register my name as a domain name, Tony Durso. And I would start building a site, and I would keep working my followers, and I would connections on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. I would start inviting people to come on to a podcast with me, and I would restart Revenue Chat in this alternate world and just start interviewing people, getting them in the box, getting things all primed and pumped, so to speak, while I'm doing the public speaking and getting some income and meeting people. Yeah, because the money for the conference is just not going to happen. That kind is not there. But I'm going to meet people and I'm going to get into opportunities. I may get into some locals that need some coaching, and I can definitely say that I would start bringing in some, you know, moderate income by the end of the first month through speaking and maybe doing some coaching and stuff like that. And then once I have enough of the website put together, I would launch Revenue Chat. I'd have a lot of people in the box already, and I would start putting out those podcasts and so forth. And meanwhile, I would be writing my next book, which, by the way, not sure if it's going to be out by this time or not, but my fourth book is coming out, called Elite Entrepreneurs. And this particular book is different in that I'm bringing on co-authors who are also experts and entrepreneurs in their field. So I would either, back to the alternate world, I would either do something like that and bring on other experts. And this way I would meet more people and meet more experts. So that might be what I do there. But for sure, one way or another, I'm going to write my next book.
There you have it, folks, from the elite entrepreneur himself. Tony, this has been tremendous. I greatly appreciate you taking the time. Please tell us where to find you. Tell us more about Revenue Chat. And you mentioned your next book coming out. Please take a few minutes to talk about that.
Sure. To reach me, I'm very approachable. Please reach out to Tony at TonyDurso.com. That's also my website there. You can find out more about the Revenue Chat show, which has been out for a year now and a couple months by the date of this recording. I've surpassed 500,000 downloads. I think I've mentioned that earlier. And I'm doing very well with some very prominent CEOs and A-list celebrities, VIPs, experts, and entrepreneurs on my show. Very, very pleased at the amount of people I have. I'm usually booked out about 6 or so months in advance, but I do put, you know, anyone that is even remotely possible to be on my show, I still, you know, give them full consideration and try to fit them in my schedule, even if it's later down the line. And Elite Entrepreneurs, my fourth book. This one's a little bit different. It's a book where I'm bringing on experts as a co-author, and together each expert co-author has a chapter in the book and tells their story and what's going on. And it's being given a lot of press and fanfare and publicity when it gets released. I have a publisher called Higher Purpose Publishing with Mike Saunders, and that's going to get a lot of press and so forth out there. And he is going to do everything in his power to make it an Amazon bestseller. I mean, we know we're going to do it. We've done it before. We know what it takes to get it there. And So yes, it's going to be an Amazon bestseller when it comes out. All the proceeds, believe it or not, are going to the Kevin Richardson Wildlife Sanctuary in South Africa. That's the Lion Whisperer. And I'm actually in talks with him about bringing him on my show as well. And we want to help the animals. You know, not going to divide, you know, the profits. It's not so easy to divide between a number of authors. So we're just going to give it all to charity. And that's even a better, higher purpose. And so that's a win-win-win for everyone.
Win-win-win for everyone. All proceeds go to charity. And there you have it, folks. Tony, thank you so much for taking the time. I greatly appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you so much for having me on, Temi. And best of luck to you on your show. I look so forward to it being launched and out there. And, you know, I'm happy to give it any kind of plugs I want on my show now and then. So we'll just stay in touch on that.
Absolutely. I look forward to it. Thanks again.
My pleasure. Thank you.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.